Now the final stage of this neckline, once it's pressed, it should sit beautifully. What we're going to do is just quickly do hand tarpai on the inside of this, because it makes it sit a lot better, and I don't really want to, it's come out absolutely beautiful, and I don't really want to ruin it by using, sometimes stitching this on the machine can actually spoil it. So we're just going to quickly use like a tacking stitch to actually tack this down with. Just the inside of this. So the inside of this is just so to do this tack, it's just a piece you take in from or take a small piece of the actual fabric and then sort of weave it in. This is one of the boring part of sewing for me. I haven't got the patience to do hand stuff. Right. So what we're going to do is follow this seam around close to the edge with the machine. So just start it off anywhere, it doesn't really matter, preferably towards the back, and keep your stitching fairly small, because this is like top stitching, so to get it like nice and neat. Go around the bloody neckline, just stitching so that the seam just sits well. Now you don't have to do this because it was sitting, this is linen and linen sits quite well anyway, but it just gives it a little bit more definition. Now the other thing that we want is, before we can actually change the foot now, because it's it makes it a lot easier to sew with a normal foot than obviously with a zip foot. Little thing that we need a little bit of a putty to go underneath the neckline. For the buttons to sit through. Use this fabric. So that's basically the neckline finished. Now we're gonna go, what I'm gonna do now is just attach the sleeves and the rest of the few seams. Whilst I'm doing this, we will carry on with our tale of what happened with my nephew and the work permits and so on. So if you want to listen to my boring story, then you can keep on, or you can mute this volume and Okay, so anyway, so what happened basically was that I acquired the work, where was I up to? Now, you know what, memory goes like a sieve, so I forget what I was talking about. Well, basically what happened was when I liked these guys' work and I got in touch with them and I said, right, I'm willing to call you over, but what you have to do for me in return is train two of my own people. Now, the reason for my getting two of my own people trained was I needed to keep an eye on these overseas workers, that they were fulfilling the commitment, and the people that I was going to call over were the people that were doing the job. So I uprooted two of my family members from our village and sent them to the city, and they started training as tailors. Now, the whole process took ages and it cost me literally thousands. During the process, I actually sent them lots and lots and lots of work from the UK to actually get it done. All the styles, all the designs, I got them to make for me, and I was actually very, very pleased with their work. So the criteria for calling somebody over was quite intense. We had to advertise in the UK to first of all make sure that who we were bringing over, they were capable for the job, and also that they were, that type of, people already available in the UK. So we had advertisements in the newspapers and so on looking for good quality tailors and seamstresses, which obviously it was impossible to get because I'd already done all my research. Finally, I managed to get the work permits for not four of the workers, but only two of the workers. I was actually quite pleased, and that was not too bad. It was quite easy to get. But in order to do that, what I had to do was I had to fulfill certain criteria. So my business had to be making a certain amount, and I had to be like a successful business person in order to do that. So stupidly, what I did was I actually slightly exaggerated the accounts and so on just to make it easier to get the work permits through, which ended up, that's another story in itself. Anyway, I managed to get the work permits, and then we applied for visas. And now, visa process was lengthy because that took place in Pakistan, and anything that happens in Pakistan is a very, very lengthy process. So first of all, between the application and the time of the visas, it took a fairly long time. But by the time the lads had to go for an interview, the two tailors that work permits got approved had to go for an interview. And they went for an interview, and it was a stupid interview where they asked them some ridiculous questions like, when you go to England, where will you be staying? Now, the lads who were coming to England had no idea of where they will be staying. So one of them went and answered something like, he was going to be living in Lancashire. Instead, he went and said something like Yorkshire, which they picked up on, and they said he doesn't know where he's going to be living. A stupid, irrelevant question, but anyway, they needed an excuse to turn down the work permits, the visas actually. So what ended up happening was, after the interview, they said they'll write to them and let them know the outcome.